It's a delight to be able to welcome you to this very first Sunday in May. As we come together, today is a day in which we are going to celebrate communion together, and I'm asking you to consider these passages from our continuing study in the book of Colossians as our communion consideration and examination of heart and life, and just take these moments to draw close to our Lord. You might see that the sermon title is just one word. In fact, just a little three-letter word called let. I trust that as we go through this service and through this sermon, you'll see its application to our preparing our hearts for the table of the Lord. Let me pray with us. Lord Jesus, I come before you right now and thank you for the opportunity to open your word, the opportunity to lift it up, and the opportunity, Lord, for you to work in us through it. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would guide us, direct us, and encourage us as we come to you today. And we'll thank you, for we ask these things in Jesus' name. And all the people out there said, amen. The word let, a three-little word, occurs 1,272 times in the New King James Version of the Bible. In Webster's dictionary, it has over seven definitions. That little three-letter word has a powerful ability to convey several spiritual dynamics for this, our communion celebration. Listen to these definitions. Three definitions of the word let that will help us in our understanding of these spiritual dynamics. First of all, to introduce a request or a proposal, like, for instance, let us pray. Or remember when I preached on Peter and he says, let's go fishing, okay? That idea of an invitation, an introduction or a request or a proposal. The second of these definitions is to free from. She let out a scream, or he let out a laugh, is the way in which that's used. And then there is the third, to permit to enter, pass, or leave. They let him out of prison. They let him out of his contract. Those three definitions are really, really important for us as we come to this passage of Scripture in Colossians chapter 3, verses 14 through 17. Let me read these passages to you. Actually, I'm going to begin in verse 12. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. And then it says this in verse 15. Those two verses were from last week's sermon. Then it says this, and let, our three-letter word, the peace of God rule in your heart, to which you also were called in one body, and be thankful. Let, our word again, the word of God dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Excuse me. That statement, that last statement, is kind of an implied let. Because it was used in the other two areas, you can also kind of transpose it for there. And let whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord, giving thanks to God the Father through him. That passage of Scripture is a great place for you and I to come in preparing our hearts for communion. When we come to that idea, let the peace of God dwell in you. Let the peace of God rule in you. Let the peace of God be in your hearts. That reminds me of that passage of scripture in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, where it says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." So there is the sense in which those three definitions of let are being used in this passage of scripture. It says, let the peace of God. First of all, there is peace with God, and there is a peace that is given to us from God. Then there comes that question of rule, and then the idea of the body, and then a thanksgiving lifestyle. Let's look at them. Because as we come to this table, as we look at the elements of the bread and the cup, the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, we're to remember him. And part of that memory today is for us to come back to let him, to let us, to let our heart, our mind, our spirits be met of him and by him. So let the peace of God rule in your hearts. Let the peace of God. Now that peace of God is twofold: peace with God and peace from God. Today you may not particularly think that you are at odds with God, but before we were saved, before we were born again, when we were lost, before we became believers in Christ, followers of Jesus, before we became disciples, we were at enmity. Good biblical word used in the epistles of Paul. We were at enmity with God. That means that we were enemies. That enmity was the fact that we had not the capacity or the capability to please him. It is only when we come to a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, it only comes when you and I are in him, that we can please him. And there needs to be a peace made with God, because we are at enmity with him, a peace with God. In fact, one of the great Billy Graham tracts that was used in the Billy Graham Association was called Peace with God. Peace. That peace is really, really important, because God's not the one who offended. God is not the one who transgressed. We were. And so we need that peace with God. And then once we come to know him, we need that peace that comes from him. Peace that comes from him. That peace that we often claim passes all understanding, even in situations which we find ourselves in today. But there is that peace with God made when we are saved, and there is that peace from God that becomes ours through a ministry of Holy Spirit in your life, in my life, that peace that passes all understanding. But then we come to the question of this idea of rule. If there is one word the Christian and Missionary Alliance expresses to us, is that the rule of faith and practice, that term rule, is through the Word of God. And so this idea of rule, not only through God's Word, but also through our peace with him, letting that peace rule in us. Rule is a word that most Americans really don't like. It kind of snubs up against our independence, our freedom. But that idea is really, really cool from this perspective. And that is the fact that you and I, when we come to Jesus Christ, claim him as our Lord. And when we claim him as our sovereign, when we claim him as our King of Kings, he has the right to rule. You have the response to obey. You have the response to be his subject. But he has the right to rule, and he will rule with his love, with his mercy, with his grace, with his peace. You and I have to find ourselves to be willing to let him rule. Not always the easiest thing for us. We don't like rules. We know that many times rules are good for us, but we don't like to be ruled. Unless it seemingly is by some sin and some wicked passion. But here it says, let the peace of God rule in you. That demands a willingness from you and I to make that rule a reality. And then he adds this to that, that we do that in the context of a body. The church is a great school for grace, for forgiveness, for love. The church is a great place. And this body that he talks about here is the church. Men and women throughout all time who've been born again. The church triumphant and the church present. Now, he says he wants that body to be the place where peace with God and peace from God will rule in us. And if we will do that, he says there is a consequence to that. We will live a thankful lifestyle. A thankful lifestyle. He tells us to be thankful. Thank him for our salvation. Thank him for our eternal destiny. Thank him for who he is. Thank him for who he's making us. Thank him. But thankful in everything else. Thankful, lifestyled people are a joy to be around. They just kind of have this magneticness to them. It doesn't seem like life bothers them or ever gets over on them or puts them under some sort of oppression because they have a thankful lifestyle. We are told to give thanks in all things. Sometimes that's really, really not very easy, is it? But we can have certainly a thankful lifestyle in everything. Even if we can't thank God for something, in it we can find that God is there. In it we can find that God is working in us. In it we can find, if we have a thankful lifestyle, that nothing will overwhelm us. Nothing. Because that thankfulness, it bubbles to the top. It finds its way through the darkness and through the difficulties. When we come to this table, let's be reminded that God tells us that we can be thankful and that we can exhibit a thankful lifestyle because he paid for that on the cross. He paid for that when he cried out, "It is finished." He paid for that in the anguish of that brutal death. He died for you and for me. He goes another step further when he uses that little three-letter word, let, again. He says, let the word of God dwell in you. Now, we're really apt to let the word of God dwell in somebody else. We like that. It's a little bit different story when we come back to the fact that, you know, well, that same word of God is supposed to dwell in me. Dwell in me. You need to take a personal responsibility. You need to take a personal responsibility to let the word of God dwell in it, in you. You've got to read it. You've got to study it. You've got to apply it. You have got to take the opportunity to let it dwell in you. You. Look at your devotional life. Look at your study life. Look at the opportunities that you find in your daily living where the word of God applies. Do you and are you letting the word of God dwell in you? But then he puts a qualifier to it. He says, let it dwell richly. Not just Yeah, he dwells in me. I mean, he's asking us richly, richly. I don't know how much money it takes to be rich. $1 million? Well, there's a lot of millionaires. Billions? Well, you know, there's quite a few billionaires in our world. I don't know what it is make you rich. I remember when Pat and I were in Burkina Faso, and we were ministering there with Harold Brass, and realizing that most of the people we saw, most of the people we watched, lived on about a dollar a day. Now, in some of the homes that they lived in, and some of the things that I saw them live in, I took the opportunity to realize when I got home what I had. For them, certainly they would think that I was rich. I look at folks and wonder what it is about rich. But if I can just for a minute, God's not telling you just to be rich. He's telling you to be filthy rich. He's telling you to be so rich that you don't even know what rich is. And he's telling you to do that in and through the Word of God. And he promises that if we will allow the Word of God to dwell in us richly, there are three things that are going to become evident. First of all, we will have a wisdom. We will have a wisdom, not a political correctness, but a wisdom, a wisdom. And also he goes on to tell us that we will have teaching. We will not only have wisdom, but we will have teaching. We'll have something to share. We'll have something to share. And then the third thing he says, we will be admonishing. Now take admonishing, and though not completely a synonym of it, think of admonishing as encouraging somebody with an edge, okay? But it's encouraging somebody. You'll have something to admonish people with, to encourage people with, to suggest to them, this is the way you should walk. If the Word of God dwells richly in us, that wisdom, that teaching, and that admonishing is something that God says are byproducts of that richness of His Word dwelling in us. When you and I come to communion today, when we will take of the elements of the bread and the cup, we are taught to remember. We are to remember that sacrifice and that death. We are taught that we have something in Christ that we are compelled to share. His wisdom, His teaching. We're to admonish, encourage, point out what God's Word and what His person suggests to our lives, to the lives of those people around us. Might you and might I take that little word, let the Word of God dwell in you richly. And then it says something about singing grace. Now, I realize that he's talking about psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. I think we ought to continually have a song in our heart. It was said that A.B. Simpson, the founder of the Christian and Missionary Alliance, when he would walk through the headquarters buildings in downtown New York, if he got on the elevator with somebody, very often he'd ask them, "Where are you?" Well, they knew where they were. They were in the elevator with A.B. Simpson. But what he wanted to know, what song are you singing in your heart? Where are you at in that song? Every once in a while, you may see somebody's, you know, foot tapping, and maybe they're mouthing words and they're singing. I think that's a great thing and a good thing. I'm not so sure that's completely what this passage is talking about, even though it uses the term singing grace in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. I think that there is that sense where he's using that term in a broader way, that our life ought to be a song of praise to him, a song of grace to him. And that is a byproduct of letting the Word of God dwell in us richly. It's a byproduct of what God has done and has placed and has set alive and on fire in our lives. It's like singing. And he says, they're like psalms, and they're like hymns, and they're like spiritual songs. Remember that the book of Psalms, much of it was the songbook of the Hebrew faith. Remember, you'll see every once in a while when you read in the Psalms, it'll say a song of ascent. Have you ever seen that? Well, basically, as the people came into worship, when they would come up to one step, they would sing a song of ascent. And then they would come up to another step, and they would sing another psalm of ascent. And then they would come to another step, and they would sing. And that way, they sang all the way into the presence of the holy place. What an incredible way to live. Now, I realize that, you know, not everybody enjoys singing. Not everybody sings well. I got this great cartoon of a man sitting in a church, and the usher taps him on the shoulder and said, "Sir, we have a remedial singing class down in the furnace room we'd like to invite you to." I always thought that was really interesting, because over the years, I've met people who, when they sing, you melt. And then there are other people, when they sing, you know, like this. Anywhere in between there is okay with me. In fact, the Bible says just to make a joyful noise to the Lord. But I think this passage is giving us an object lesson. It's giving us an illustration. It's talking about psalms and hymns and spiritual songs of our lives based and rooted in the Word of God. It's like a singing that takes place. In our worship service that is taking the opportunity to be recorded today, we're singing some really great songs that get our hearts right for communion, to give praise to what God is doing. An important part of letting the Word of God dwell in you richly. And then the final thing that I want us to look at is an implied let. In fact, in your outline, I put it, let whatever you do in word or deed, do it all in his name and all through him. Whatever you do, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might, with all your ability. Doesn't call you and I to examine whether or not we have the capability or the ability. He's only looking for people who have the availability. God will take whatever we have, whatever we are, whatever we can do, and there is a place in which he can use it for his glory. Let whatever you do in word or in deed, pretty much covers it, right? We're all talking at some point, aren't we? And we're all doing things at some point. He says, let each of them be done, whatever you do, all in his name and all through his name. There is only one thing exempt, only one thing exempt from this let whatever you do, and that is you cannot praise God. You cannot rejoice in God. You cannot in his name or through him sin. It is the one thing that isn't covered by whatever you do. It would be really, really asinine for me to stand up in front of you and say, if you're going to be a bank robber, be the best bank robber you can be. Because the Bible teaches us not to steal. And so you can take that little kind of over-the-top idea and realize that God in his name and God through his person and will and work in our lives, our word or our deed, doing it with everything we have to the glory of God, doesn't extend to sin. Doesn't extend to sin. Paul says, what? Should I sin more so grace could abound more? He says, God forbid that that would happen. That's not what we're talking about here. But anything that turns the light on for you, anything that you enjoy, anything, did I mention anything? Can be used to the glory of God, to be used in word or deed in his name. And all of that through him. Very shortly, we're going to take the opportunity to celebrate communion together. And as we celebrate communion, we take the opportunity to encourage every person to be reminded that when it says, as often as you do this, you do show the Lord Jesus until he come again. Every time I think of that, I am reminded of my life between that time when at York College of Pennsylvania, I gave my heart to Jesus Christ, to today when I stand before you, all of that life is to remember what he's done. To remember and to honor what my Savior accomplished on that cross. That with ever word or deed I'm involved in, that I remember that it's all in his name and that it is all in him. So today let me encourage you to give consideration to a little three-letter word, let. Because you see, God is introducing to you a request and a proposal. Let this. God is setting you free from yourself and from sin and saying, let this be you. And he is permitting us to enter and to pass and leave a life that is broken, a life that is battered and bruised, a life that is outside of him, to be drawn in and to embrace what he says to let. That's why those three definitions are so very important of this little three-letter word. Let the peace of God rule in your heart, in your life. Let the word of God dwell richly in you. And let whatever you do, in word or in deed, be all in his name. And be done and accomplished because it's all through him. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, I ask in these moments that you would encourage our hearts and our minds and our spirits, that you would, Lord, make yourself known in our midst. And we will thank you together. So we ask these things, Jesus, in your matchless and precious name. And all the people said, amen. For those of you who are visiting with us at home and have just taken the opportunity to watch the sermon on let, now comes the opportunity for us to celebrate the table of the Lord together. Let the peace of God rule in our heart. Let the word of God dwell in us richly. And let whatever we do, we're down to the glory, the honor, and the grace of Jesus Christ.
The Bible teaches us that on the night in which Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and gave thanks for it. Gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my life given for you." Let's pray. Lord, as folks at home take their bread and as I take this, I ask that we would be reminded that we're to remember you, to remember your death on the cross, to take and allow you to minister to all of us with all of yourself. You paid that price so that we might live. And we remember you right now through this element of broken bread. For I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. After supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood, the new testament in my blood, shed for the remission of sin." Gives an invitation to his disciples seated around that table. "Take and drink ye all of it." And so that invitation is for each of us not only to realize his broken body, but also realize the power of his shed blood. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, the blood that you shed on that awful afternoon outside of Jerusalem speaks throughout the ages of forgiveness, speaks throughout the ages of being the answer for our redemption, for our sin. And so I ask that in these moments, we would remember that the blood washes away our sin. That the blood establishes in each of us a rightness, a righteousness, and a cleanness before God. I thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Why do we partake together? The scripture tells us as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we show the Lord's death until he comes again. And we're waiting that day when we will hear him with the shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God. Those who are in the grave will rise to meet the Lord, and we will rise with them to greet him in the air. Until he comes. Thank you, Jesus, for this reminder of your sacrifice on that cross. We remember it, and we remember you, and ask you to fill us with yourself. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.